myself, I've been involved with Enova for some months now, and also my husband, Scott Bart, who is over there in the corner. So, you know, feel free to ask any of us questions that you have in the end as well. So basically for tonight, Steve will tell about Enova, and in the end, Alec will have a few words, and then we'll just have some coffee, tea, and little snacks that we'll provide.
Cake.
So
cake.
We have cake. So everyone, thank you for coming. Thanks for Cleaners for hosting this, and thanks for Enova to travel here for us. So, Steve.
Thank you very much for just trying to just make sure that I'm right. And again, thank you for putting up, for inviting me and putting on the evening tonight. Look, tonight is about talking to you about an investment opportunity in a new energy retailer. Now, what you need to think about in an investment, probably three things. One is, is this a good cause? Is this really something you want to invest in? Is it actually a good investment? So will it make money and return your investment, or survive for the longer course? And probably from this group's point of view, is it replicable, and can you use this to do something similar to what we're trying to do in the Northern Rivers region? So tonight the presentation is around, you'll see a lot of talk about community, local community, and the impact on the local community. What I'm talking about here is the Northern Rivers community. So I'll talk about the amount of money we hope to be able to keep within the Northern Rivers community as a result of what we're doing, the sort of projects that we can do within the Northern Rivers. But there's no reason why doing what we're doing can't be done elsewhere. So you may want to think about it as how we get something like this up and running to begin with, and then replicate it through other communities around Australia. And we have had a lot of interest from other communities around Australia, very keen to see us get up and running and help them go through the same thing. The difficulty up until now with communities doing something in the renewable space has been around having a retailer that will support them. And a retailer is the likes of Origin, AGL, Energy Australia, Momentum, PowerShop. They're all examples of retailers. Wanting to support, you need a retailer if you're going to start your own generation, community-owned generation projects. You need a retailer to support you to buy that energy and on-sell it to either your customers or a customer base. Up until now, the large retailers just aren't interested. Not that they're not, not that they're bad people, it's just the scale of their operations are just so much bigger, and are just not geared to supporting smaller scale operations. And that's really where Enova came from, realising that the community in the Northern Rivers area wanted to do a whole range of things around renewable energy, around energy efficiency, but didn't have the support of the retailers to be able to fulfil on what their project was. Now, Enova is the first energy company, first community-owned energy company in Australia to actually be granted a retail licence. About 3 weeks ago, we were finally granted our retail licence. We're very proud of that fact. That enables us now to go on and do the sort of things that we need to do to support the local community. So it's within that context that I just want to talk tonight about who Enova is, what we plan to do, and what the opportunities might be. So, what is our mission? It really is about reducing carbon emissions from the energy that we produce. You probably all heard the facts before. A third of Australia's greenhouse gas emissions comes from the burning of fossil fuels to generate electricity. It's the single biggest emitter of greenhouse gas emissions per industry. It's double that of more than double that of vehicles or agriculture or transport. Airline, people talk about the amount of emissions emitted from the airline industry. That's about 4%. 33% comes from the generation of electricity. So it's massive compared with all the other things. And it's also one of the easiest things to change. With renewable energy, it's really easy to move away from fossil fuels to renewable energy. Tim Flannery's latest book, he quotes a figure in there of the amount of sunlight that hits the earth every day could generate 4,000 times more energy than the earth is, than the world is currently generating through fossil fuel electricity. So there's no shortage of alternatives to fossil fuels. It's a matter of getting on and doing something about it. And that's what Enova's mission is about assisting the community to reduce its carbon emissions. And that we'll do in two ways, and I'll cover that in a minute. The other component of it is trying to keep the amount of profits and operating costs that goes out of the region now to these large energy companies. As an example, in the Northern Rivers region, electricity bills for the average consumer amount to about $300 million a year. $80 million of that can be kept within the region, either through profits or through operating costs. So if you could set up your own call centre, your billing systems and that sort of thing in the local region, those costs don't go out, and neither do all the profits that go with it. That we estimate that there's around $80 million if all the customers in the Northern Rivers region were to switch energy companies to us, that would be $80 million we can keep in the local economy. That is a massive amount of money, and that can be done right around Australia. Now, as part of that, what we want to do is whatever profits that we make and the costs that we keep, we want to keep within the region and reinvest to help the community, not only with renewable generation, but around energy efficiency and other projects there. So, how are we going to do it? We're going to help reduce carbon emissions. We're going to focus on the sale of 100% renewable energy, and that will be the accredited green power, which is additional to the renewable energy target. So anything we sell is over and above whatever the renewable energy target is. So it's additional there. We want to support and facilitate community generation. So there's lots of small communities around us, around the Northern Rivers and around Australia, that are wanting to get their own projects up and running. We will step in and act as the friendly retailer to support those, to buy the energy from them and to them to resell it. We want to work by installing, one of our arms will be to install solar and battery and other technologies. So not only will we sell energy, we are seeing a move from just being people just buying energy from the grid and using it to people putting solar in, is a good example. 20% of the customers in the Northern Rivers region actually have solar on their roofs now, so that's a massive take-up. That will continue to grow, but other technologies are coming along too, and there's a lot of talk about the battery technology. It's still expensive today, but there's no doubt that battery technology is going to have a massive impact on the way we interact with the grid and what that's going to happen with energy in the future. So part of our model is to not only sell energy, but be part of the technology side of it to help people select the best technology for them, whether that be solar panels, whether it be batteries or any other new technologies that come in. We want to act as an independent, unbiased advice. We don't care if people want to go off the grid. What we want to do is make sure that if they go off the grid, they're doing it with the right equipment and they're doing it for the right reason. So we'll give them that advice. If they go off the grid, it means as a retail, we don't get their energy. But hopefully we will sell the equipment to them and maintain that equipment. So it doesn't matter to us. We're unbiased as to which side of the coin it is. And of course, the best thing we can do is use the energy that we are generating more efficiently. So rather than having to make it all from renewables, we just reduce the amount of energy we're using without actually compromising our lifestyle, but you can actually introduce energy efficiencies to make use less energy. Now the second part of it is the community benefit. I've already said that we will keep operating costs and that sort of thing in the region and profits. Already, before we've even started, we're already employing people to run websites for us and marketing people. We've got accountants and finance people that we're already in, and legal people that we're already engaged in. So they're indirect employment, that, and our policy is to employ locally where we can. So we have a local employment policy. If we can't get it locally, well then we have to go outside the region, but it is to support the local business. And obviously to run the business is to employ people within the region. We're going to be majority community owned, and what that means is the Northern Rivers community, it'll be majority owned by the Northern Rivers. So 51% of the shares in the company need to come from the Northern Rivers. And importantly, the amount of profit that we make, we're a social enterprise, so not only do we want to return profits back to investors, but we also want to return profits back to the community. So we have a not-for-profit arm, of which half the profits go to the not-for-profit arm to be reinvested back into community projects and to help with energy efficiency and also to help people that perhaps can't get involved in, haven't got the money to be able to buy solar panels today. How do they get involved in the solar revolution? So we want to support all elements of the community to bring them along. It's not just the top end or the middle class that are going to help reduce our greenhouse gas emissions. We've got to cover the whole community. Everybody's got to do their bit, and that's what our not-for-profit arm will do. And the last point, which is important, I guess, to you guys, is we want to help other communities. Once we've got up and operating, we want to help other communities do what we've done in their community so they can get the same benefits. The structure of the company, when you buy shares, you buy them in the Enova Community Energy Limited. Under that company, we have three arms. There's the retail arm, or the energy division, which is the retail and the solar installation, battery installation business. That is where most of the investment in the company goes. That's where most of the money initially will go to be able to set up and run that business. In the future, we want to have a finance arm so that we can help when other communities want to raise capital or even renewable energy projects within the community, they want to raise capital to get their project back and running. We will have a financial services license that will enable, that it's the vehicle that will enable others to raise money through. It's not our money, but we will enable them to raise the capital. That'll be a vehicle that can be used there, and we'll have the expertise. But over time, we might even be able to raise additional capital and get into some sort of leasing arrangements and that sort of thing. And finally is the not-for-profit arm, which will initially we'll be getting grants from, or applying for grants from the government to help with energy efficiency projects and energy education. So that's the company. Now, what I want to do, people get a little confused as to what a retailer is as opposed to what a distribution company is as opposed to generation. Basically, the energy industry, there are three major components to it. You've got generation, and most of the generation in Australia is from fossil fuel. You've got just out here, massive generation. You've got lots of smaller renewable generation, but the bulk of it comes from fossil fuel generation out here. Then you've got distribution. The distribution is the businesses that actually run the poles and wires in the streets. In our region, that's Essential Energy. Out here, it's probably Endeavour, would be the distribution company.
Energy Australia.
Basically, what they are, their role is to transport the energy through the grid and to maintain the grid and make sure that branches come down across the wires, someone goes out and fixes them. So their job is to run that. It doesn't matter whether you're a small energy company like us or whether you're a large energy company like Origin Energy, we all use the grid and it's a regulated system and we all pay the same amount. So there's no bias between small energy companies or large energy companies, that large energy companies don't get bulk discounts or anything like that. We're all treated equally as far as that's concerned. And then finally, retail. That's where Enova fits in. We're a retailer, just like Origin or AGL. We're the ones that collect we pay the generator for the energy, we pay the distribution company for putting the energy through the grid, we have our billing system and we employ people, and we package all of that together and we send you a bill. When probably at the day that the bills arrive, we're probably the most hated organisation around getting their electricity bills, but someone's got to do it and that's where we fit. In New South Wales, the market is dominated by AGL, Origin and Energy Australia. 91% of all customers buy their energy from one of those three companies. They're all involved in coal seam gas in one form or another, and that's certainly been a big issue in the Northern Rivers and one of the things that sparked off community attitude toward other energy companies in the region. And they're all involved in fossil fuel generation. Most of them have bought some of the assets. In our region, Origin's the dominant supplier. Origin bought the country energy business back about 5 years ago, and probably 80% of the customers in the Northern Rivers region buy their energy from Origin Energy. We've seen Power Shop as a newer retailer on the scene. They package it up and do things a little differently. So there are different models around as to how it works. Now, this particular slide shows really what we've had for 80, 90 years. We've had, and it was probably given the technology we had 80 or 90 years ago, it was the logical thing to do. Although in hindsight, the damage it's done, we might question that. But we have a very low cost fuel, a black coal, large power stations put through a grid distribution, through a high voltage distribution, back through Ausgrid system down to the house. That's the way the model is today and has been for 80 or 90 years. Right or wrong, that's what we've got. But that is changing with the advent of the way cost of solar is coming down, the advent of battery technologies, the cost and reliability of that, along with even electric vehicles and that sort of thing. Technology and how we control things, all of that, the old way, is going to change. I doubt that we will ever see another coal-fired power station built in Australia. It is actually cheaper if you had to build a new coal-fired power station. It's actually cheaper to do it with renewables than with coal. So I don't think we'll ever see another coal-fired power station built. Which means what we're going to see is lots of smaller scale solar farms, wind farms, that sort of thing, much closer to where the energy is needed, rather than transporting it, in our case, hundreds of kilometres through distribution systems with line losses along the way, we're going to see a lot more local generation. We're going to see a lot of houses doing their own thing through and storing the energy that they generate, and even community scale storage, whether that be through the distribution company or whether it's communities getting together and deciding they want to actually be a generator in a different sort, that they want to store the energy at one point and then release it and act almost as a generator through batteries. And of course we're going to see perhaps more people go off the grid. Now in our region there will never be, well certainly not in the next 5 or 6 years anyway, enough locally produced energy to meet the full community demand. So we're still going to have to be connected to the main distribution system and get our energy from larger scale generation. We'll see more larger scale solar, we'll see more wind farms being built, and we'll see less fossil fuel being used. Now the difference between the old model and the new model is that the existing energy companies are pretty much locked into, that's where their money is today. Our money in the future will be in that model, not in that model. So we're geared up to go forward with a new model and to adapt as new technologies and changes occur. We will be able to adapt very quickly with it. Where I would suggest that there's vested interests by some of the larger energy companies today in keeping that model pretty much where it is at the moment. So the message there is we're looking for the future, not the past. In Germany, in fact, nearly half the renewable energy is owned by communities. So that's an example of what has happened overseas, and it's an example that we should be looking to follow here in Australia. Now, the one thing that you'll miss or won't see in the presentation tonight is a set of numbers, of what our profit and loss will be and what the investor returns will be and that sort of thing. I'd love to be able to share that with you. We've done an enormous amount of work and I'd love to be able to show the model off to you. Unfortunately, as a startup, ASIC, who are the regulator for raising capital, say we're not allowed to share that information with you. Basically because we don't have any history of being able to make projections. So therefore, we can't share, which makes it very difficult when you're trying to raise money, get to investors, if you can't actually tell them what they can expect. What I can tell you though is that what our customer take-up will look like, and we expect to get, and this is fairly conservative, in our region there's 130,000 potential customers. We are targeting about 2,000 in the first year, 2,000 in the second year, and then about 1,500, and then sort of pretty much flattening off to about 8,000 customers over 6 years. It's not a massive target, it's quite conservative, but we haven't wanted to over-exaggerate what we think we're capable of doing. We think that's quite within the realms of possibility, given that the number and the type of support we're getting from the community and the type of product we'll have. What is important though is that a typical retailer like us or any other retailer that's starting up needs between 4,000 and 5,000 customers to break even and to start to turn a profit. So tonight when I go a bit more detail, if you think that what we're offering, that we could potentially achieve that target over 6 years, then you could be fairly safe to say we should be profitable. If you don't think you can, then don't invest in us. Now, the group of people we're going to target are people that that are environmentally aware and want to do something for the environment. We know from an Ipsos poll, Ipsos is a market research company, late last year, They did some research. 40% of people said climate change was a top issue for action, and 50% renewable energy was a priority for action. So what it shows there is people get the connection between generating electricity from fossil fuels and what renewables can do. And they're also, what that suggests is that where our politicians are at and what they're legislating and where most of the community is at, there's a fair gap. And even more recent poll, that 80% of people are concerned about climate change. And 73% say that the renewable energy target should be well and truly above what the government is legislating, which is around 23%, saying it should be at least double that. So what it's showing is that the community's attitude and desire for action is well ahead of where the government's thinking and where our legislators are at. So who are we going to target? Northern Rivers region, 130,000 potential customers. About 20% of those, we think, are concerned about climate change and are prepared to put their money where their mouth is. Now, I used to work for Origin Energy and I ran the Green Power program there. When I was running that Green Power program, 25% of Origin's customers, at that stage, they had about 2 million customers, 500,000 of their customers were actually paying $1 a week more to buy 25% of their energy from Green Power. So I know it can be done. And I know that in the Northern Rivers region, I'm sure that the people that are concerned about environment are much higher than what Origin's average customer base was. So if the average customer base, 25% are prepared to do it, then you would think that 20% of people in the Northern Rivers region would be prepared to do it. The Northern Rivers region, as I said before, has 20% of the households have PV on their roof generating their own electricity. So they're already doing something for the environment. Now there is probably a crossover between those two. So some of these people will be the environmentally aware, and some of these people may want PV, but for one reason or another can't have it. We think that there's probably a market in the order of 40,000 customers that we could potentially target with environmentally friendly type offers and products. If you look at that too, so there's 26,000 there, 27,000, 52,000, bit of crossover, 40,000 is probably our target market. So what are we going to offer? The first one is we want to offer 100% green power to this particular group of market, and it will be at the best rate. We will offer, the market offer will be $1 a week, a flat dollar a week, not about, it'll be $1 a week for 100% renewable energy. Four times cheaper than what Origin's product is. That's per meter. So if you have an off-peak product as well, it'd be another $1 a week for the hot water. So that is a very compelling offer for the people that want to actually buy renewable energy, good renewable energy, to do something about it. The second group are the people that have got the solar panels on their roof. We want to offer them the best feed-in tariff available. At the moment, most people that aren't on the premium feed-in tariff, which expires at the end of next year, those that are getting 60 cents a kilowatt hour, that finishes end of next year. Half the people in New South Wales are probably getting that. The other half are getting whatever their retailer offers, which is somewhere between 5 to 6, 7 cents a kilowatt hour. We want to offer a much better rate to actually encourage people to make the economics of putting solar on the roof better. So the more we can offer, the more people will put it on. Now we will also have for people that are price sensitive, people that are struggling to pay their bill at the moment, they need to get a discount off their electricity, we will offer a discounted product. We can't leave, we debated about this, whether we should just sell 100% renewable or should we actually bring some of the other community along with us. So we're going to do that. That way, by having them, we can talk to them about energy efficiency, we can talk to them about, over time, moving to more renewable energy. And over time, our excess profits will make up, we will buy the renewable energy on their behalf anyway, so we will be 100% renewable energy. A couple of weeks ago, the Sydney Morning Herald published a report done by the St Vincent de Paul Society. And they did some analysis on how much margin there was in electricity retailing. And they're the results they got. Now, I've done the margins in New South Wales, and I know they're spot on. They're, and I've also looked at in Victoria. The numbers that they came up with are within 1% or 2% are right. So, in Victoria, electricity retail is making 45% gross margin. It is obscene, the amount of profit that these
guys are making. Deregulation.
That is deregulation for you.
Gone wrong.
In New South Wales, New South Wales only lifted their price cap for people that hadn't entered the market last year, but there is no price cap anymore on the electricity prices in New South Wales. New South Wales is a couple of years behind Victoria. Last year, on the 1st of July this year, the networks, in the essential energy network in our region, had to reduce their network costs. They reduced it by 30%. I can assure you that Origin, the dominant retailer in our region, did not pass that full 30% through. They passed some of it through and they kept some. Next year, the networks are going to have to reduce their prices again. So prior to the network reduction, it was about 26, 27%. In a year, it's gone to 30. Next year, I suspect it'll be 33, 34%. We are heading in the same direction as Victoria. So we will see the margin on electricity as a retailer getting bigger and bigger. If we had 8,000 customers, and I'll do the maths, make it easy for you, that's $4 million margin as a retailer we would make, we can make and will make if we got that amount. That's more than enough money to give back to investors, to be able to share it with the community, and to be able to offer subsidised renewable energy, help better feed in tariffs and that sort of. There's more than enough profit there to spread it around to make, rather than those profits going back to investors, which probably most of them with super funds have probably got some investment in those companies anyway, but we want to keep it within the region. So there's more than enough profit in retailing to do what we want to do. You know, give it back to investors, give it back to the community, and give it back to customers. There's a couple of comments that were that they made about people in the market. Particularly this last one, when households move into a competitive market contract, so you ring up your company and ask them for a discount, and they'll gladly give you a discount. I mean, they're probably not going to be too proactive in coming and giving it to you without you contacting them, but they'll give you a discount. But at the end of 12 months, that discount stops. If you don't keep going back to them and asking for, you go back and you're paying back at these margins again. So it only lasts 12 months before you have to do the shopping around again and do it. And I know what the strategy is for the large energy companies, and that's they rely on customer apathy. They rely on the customers doing the work initially and then forgetting about it. And then 2 or 3 or 4 years later, they wake up, oh, where's my discount gone? Oh, I must have a look at that. For the last 3 years, they've been paying the full amount. Now, I know I do the same with my car insurance, with my health insurance. I shop around and get the right price, set and forget. And each year, out from my credit card comes the deduction for my car insurance. Out each month comes the, from my bank account comes the health insurance. And I think, gee, I must shop around this year. I must do something about it. I must check to see. Yeah, I'll do that tomorrow. And, you know, 3 years later, I still haven't done it. And that's what the energy companies rely on, is that same apathy within the market of people not actually shopping around and getting back to their problems. Now, where are we? So that sort of summarises sort of the retail business and where, as much as I can really tell you about where margins are and what an investment might be. About a month ago, we received our retail license. Our capital raising closes off at the end of this month. Assuming we raise the necessary capital, we'll commence building our retail operations. That'll probably take us a couple of 2 to 3 months to get those up and running before we can take customers on and start acting as their retailer. But immediately, as soon as we've got the capital raised, we'll be able to start to sell and install solar panels and so forth. We will also start applying for grants through our not-for-profit arm to start to go out and help the community reduce their energy and talk to them about energy education and energy efficiency. And then early next year, probably around late January, early February, we'll commence the retail operation. That's the time scale as to where we're going. Share details, we opened on the 20th of August, we closed on the 27th. The region, the Northern Rivers region, we must get 51% of voting shares in the Northern Rivers region. That's written into our constitution. That is to make sure that, because that's where we've set up, that the benefits and control stays with the local community, that we do what the local community want. The other thing I'll just add there is that if you buy shares, you can buy as many shares as you like, and I hope you do, but of all the shares you buy, up only 5 of your shares, so if you bought 20 shares, only 5 of those 20 actually carry voting rights. So if someone like Origin liked our model and wanted to buy into the business and buy $1 million worth of shares, they only get 5 voting rights, no more than someone that's bought 5 shares. And that is to ensure that we can't be taken over by another large organisation. So we will always be for the benefit, run by the community, for the benefit of the community. The shares are $1,000 each. We want to raise nearly, there's 3,953 on offer. The reason it's that funny number is that some people have already invested and have given us capital to enable us to get going to the point we are. So that capital that they've already invested will convert to shares. To get going, we need to get a minimum of $3 million or 3,000 shares. And we're about a third of the way, about two-thirds of the way there at the moment. With any investment, there are risks associated with it. We are a startup. We don't have a history. I mean, we've got experienced people running the business. We think we know what we're doing. But at the end of the day, we are still a startup business. The shares, there is no liquidity. In other words, you can't trade those shares through the ASX. So you buy shares, we will help you by posting on our website the ability to put you in touch with someone that may want to buy the shares, and then you would negotiate a price between you. We can't enter into any negotiations on price assumptions. What we have decided, though, to do is that In a couple of years' time, we are going to actually list on a smaller secondary exchange, probably the NSX, which will then give you liquidity, and you can see what the value of shares and so forth, just like you can any other trading company. The reason we didn't do that to begin with is that the administrative costs are just too high at the startup phase for us. We needed to get going. It was just too big a burden to begin with. So, but we will be listing in a couple of years' time. With anything, as I said before, really the whole financial viability of the company is going to depend on getting customers. If we can't get 5,000 customers, we will eventually go broke. It's as simple as that. That we need 4,000 to 5,000 to cover our fixed operating expenses. I think we can do that and do better, but it's your judgment, because it is about how many customers we get. That really drives the financial model of the business. Everything, all the other costs, the OPEX, if we blow the OPEX, we stress tested the model, and even if we went over 20%, 30%, 40% in operating expenses, it's not a killer for the company. We won't get as much return on the dividends, we won't make as much profit, but the OPEX, believe it or not, is much smaller impact on the profitability of the company than the customer numbers. It really is, it's about getting customer numbers. So it's very important when we do get up and operational is to quickly get customers on. And finally, there's the opportunity. The opportunity is to get involved, to create a sense of ownership in our community. That's what we want to do. We want to take over the power for the future. It is about the future and what we can do for the community. It is part of a genuine change. I genuinely believe the energy industry, look back in 20 years' time, it will look significantly differently to what it is today. And it's a lasting change for the benefit of all. So, there is that opportunity to invest today, get us up and operational, so that we can then help other local communities do exactly the same. So, to get involved, hop onto our website, enovaenergy.com.au. You can download a copy of the prospectus there. You can do it online, just with BPay, or you can print out the form and fill it in and post it in with a cheque. So they're either electronically or snail mail. There are two ways of doing it. If you do it, or for whatever reason you can't do it, please tell others about us and get them to invest. We need to spread that word around. And we are also, particularly in our region anyway, looking for volunteers to help us both at this stage and once we've got the company up and operational. We want people helping us continue to run. So that's it from me. I'm happy to answer any questions that anybody has about it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So what strategy do you have to promote to get the customers on board? Like what strategy, advertising, promotion?
Good question. We've got on our website, you can pre-register as a customer base. We will be using social media, we'll be using farmers markets, we'll be out there using volunteers in the local communities. Lock the Gate is a large organisation up in our region. I'm sure what's going on out the back here. They want to support us, along with other community groups. There's a lot of community groups want to support us there. So we'll be tapping into all of those community groups and spreading the word around that to get people on. And certainly, investors, if we had...
So that's for people just in the Northern Rivers, yes?
Yeah. Yeah. We can take customers on... Our retail licence allows us to operate right across the eastern seaboard, with the exception of Victoria. So that's Queensland, New South Wales, ACT, South Australia and Tasmania. We can sell energy to customers in any of those states, except Victoria. Victoria, for some reason, have kept control of their own licence regulation. We can apply for a licence in Victoria, and if there was enough demand, we probably would and go for it. But to begin with, we want to focus on our region, our area, or people that are in the essential energy network. So that's basically from Bega to Broken Hill to Byron Bay, you know, all of country New South Wales. It's the same, whatever we offer in the Northern Rivers region as a product, we would offer anybody else in the essential energy network. We won't initially have an offer in the Ausgrid Endeavour region because it complicates billing and it's a different offer because the networks are all different and we've got to set up different arrangements with networks. So it's easy for us just to focus initially on the essential energy area, but as communities or demand outside of that area grows, then we will look at selling and having offers available more broadly, but not in the first instance. We think we're going to have our hands full just managing what we've got to begin with.
You've answered my question.
Oh, excellent.
Well, I just wanted to ask you about network charges.
Yes.
Whether you were able to negotiate, if it's produced locally and used locally, whether you're able to negotiate a lower network charge.
I wish.
Still hasn't.
Two comments on network charges. I haven't done the maths in this region, but I know in our region, 55% of your electricity bill is actually network charges. Mm-hmm. It's a massive part. You pay people that put solar on their roof and want to sell it to their neighbour, or you've got a business here and you've got a business next door, you've got solar on one roof, you want to use that energy to your business next door, you've got to use the network to take that energy through. You pay the same to take it 50 metres as whether it's all 500 kilometres. It's the same price. They don't distinguish between short distances and long distances today. What is happening with Essential, and I suspect a couple of the other networks are probably working on a similar sort of thing, is a trial going on called virtual net metering trial, which does recognise that there are lower costs for distributing energy over a much shorter distance, and trying to work out how that would work. What are the real costs, and coming up with a lower rate for distributing energy over a much shorter distance. Now, the networks aren't, because they're regulated, aren't required to do that, so at the moment they're working on a voluntary basis, but I think they probably see the writing on the wall. If they don't start to behave differently, then we're going to see a mass defection from the networks. They've got to change the way they're going to do things. Either economically they'll do it because people will move off, or the regulator hopefully we'll step in and force that change that's necessary. We've got to see that change. We know that model I put up with, that is the future, and it's got to be reflected in the network tariffs. But as an energy company, we can't negotiate anything any more than anybody else can negotiate anything, and they are difficult to deal with. They're slow to move. But they are moving, but it's going to take time. But that really is going to be, when we get that change, that will really start to dramatically, that's one of the changes that I think will happen, and it's going to start to dramatically change the economics of the way we do things for local distributed generation.
I'm just wondering, there seems to be some similarities with the kind of Bendigo bank model.
Ah, very good pick up. There are similarities, and in fact, we're talking to the Bendigo Bank right at the moment. They see similarities, and they've come to us and said they would, if necessary, if we can't raise enough capital from retail investors like yourselves, they've suggested that they would come in behind us and initially loan us money, but convert that loan into an equity arrangement further down the track. because they see the similarities between what they've done and the way they've operated and what we're proposing to do. So they want to be involved in us. They see benefits to them in being involved in something like us just as much as the benefits that we would get from them being involved in us. Now, those are early day discussions yet, so we'll see how it evolves. But yes, there are similarities between the two. Strong similarities.
So for risks, so what are the risks? Could any legislation changes affect the retail? What could all the larger retail? So I think you said 91% is owned by AGL and Origin and so forth, and they dominate the market. So is there a risk that they could lobby the government to say, look, this is a bit of a threat to us, or is it just it's like What percentage of the market are you after, from what they have?
Yeah,
well, risk?
Whenever you have, Coles and Woolworths type monopoly or an Origin AGL Energy Australia type monopoly, you've always got those risks that they can use undue powers or to make it difficult for others to operate. And unfortunately, the ACCC is pretty much awake up to that sort of thing and keeps a close eye on it. The Australian Energy Regulator is the one that basically regulates both the retail side of the business for the areas of regulation and licences. There is a lot of regulation around. Now, our view of the large retailers is that, as I said before, most people, some people may have negotiated an offer and have rolled off that offer and back paying for their retail price. It's most unusual for your existing energy company to come to you and offer you a discount. It just doesn't happen, it rarely happens. When people come to us, when we switch customers from, let's say, Origin to Enova, we put in a transfer into the market to tell Origin that that customer is now going to leave them and they're going to come to us and to give them a final bill to settle the account and come to us. Origin have 3 days to object. They won't object, but what they'll do is ring the customer and say, hey, why are you going? We love you. We're going to give you a better deal than what those guys are going to do. Please stay with us. I would suggest to any customer when they get the phone call to say to them, when was the last time you rang me and offered me a better deal? For the last 5 years you've been ripping me off. And now you're coming to me and saying you're going to look after me? I don't think so. That's not the behaviour of an energy company. That's the difference between us. We will look after the customers for the life. And we will tell everybody this is what's going to happen. Now, if you want the cheapest price, and that's all they basically deal with is big discounts, if that's what you want the cheapest price, we're not in the market of competing with that. We can't. We don't have the pockets that those guys have got for the short term. They can give quite deep discounts for 12 months. They're relying on the customer after that to forget about it and go back to the full price. We don't have the cash flows to do that. So we'll simply tell the customer, look, you're going to get this phone call. If this happens, if that's what you're looking for, go to Origin now and negotiate a really good price. Don't waste our time by coming with us and then switching. But if that's not the company you want to deal with, just tell them where to go when they give you the call. I think that's the approach that we'll take.
Funny, I got that exact point. it was from Origin.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm waiting on mine.
But it's about 2 weeks after.
Because I've just switched to PowerShop.
Yep.
Now, I'm kind of interested that, of course, PowerShop is not offering shares, so they're already in up and running business.
Yep.
But there is that sense, that community element. GetUp must be getting the kickback, and Oxfam. Oxfam has come through and saying, listen, do this and we'll get the cost from it. So I'm just interested, given that they've come out of nowhere and had a way of marketing through good organisation, how you differ from them. I guess you've already said some of your money goes back into the community. I don't know what's happening.
Yeah, look, the difference between, that is the fundamental. I mean, PowerShop have come out of, they've got a different discount model. To get the discount from PowerShop, you've got to jump online each week or each month and buy forward your energy. You know, they'll put out a deal and you've got to engage in it. That will work for people that want to get engaged in energy, and I'm sure the deals are good. And you'll, if you continue to interact with them, you'll do okay out of it. But my experience with customers and interaction is, it's set and forget. They do it once, they don't want to have to do this every week or every month. So eventually, and again, PowerShop, from that point of view, I suspect their behaviour and their model is no different to any other energy company. They're relying on customers, eventually just forgetting about it, not being involved in it, can't be bothered, and you'll end up paying more for it. The other thing is that they are New Zealand, 51% New Zealand owned. So the profits not only don't stay within the community, they don't even stay in the country. So our model is about looking after the community. It's about the profits that we can generate, it's about helping the community do better things with energy. It's about supporting the local generation. Now, PowerShop, I'm sure, don't do that. They're not going to get involved with the, you know, the up in Mullumbimby, a small town up in northern New South Wales, want to put panels on the drill hole to generate electricity. They've raised some money and they want to do it. PowerShop aren't going to get involved in that. They're not going to put the problem. They're not employing people locally.
You know, okay, so leaving that one aside, how's Clean As kind of connected with
Well, I'll when we finish the question, I'll talk about that.
But the other thing with PowerShop, I mean, yes, they do provide GetUp and those and other organisations. There is certainly a kickback, and in fact,
and it's 100% renewable.
No, it's not. It's quite different. It's not 100% renewable. It's power. To me, it's greenwashing. It's acting on people's ignorance of how the market works. PowerShop is owned by a generator that is 100. They only have 100% renewable generation. PowerShop don't buy their energy from their generator. PowerShop buy the energy from the grid, as every other retailer does. They don't buy it straight from their own company. If you want renewable energy from PowerShop, the green power, you have to buy it just like you do us or from Origin Energy and pay more for it. The last time I looked at the numbers in PowerShop, about 10% of their customers were buying green power. 90% are buying black grid energy. What PowerShop do is buy carbon offsets from overseas to offset the emissions associated with the generation.
That's the difference in the world.
To me, look, offsets, it's better than nothing. But it's a bit like spilling milk and using a Wettex to mop it up again. You're better off not spilling the milk in the first place rather than trying to clean up the mess after you've made it. That's my view of carbon offsets. Then why we shouldn't need carbon offsets if we have the energy from a renewable source to begin with.
Yeah. But Energy Australia does a lot of greenwashing, that's for sure. Like the logos and the way they get their energy from it.
Green is a segment of the market that all energy companies want to be associated with to try to cover up everything else they're doing. I don't blame them, that's marketing.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the reality of it, though. It does act on people's ignorance of how the market actually operates, which annoys me.
Can you explain how green power works and how that brings about green generation?
Yeah. Green Power is a government-run program. It's it credits renewable generation. So not all renewable generation is accredited under Green Power. Green Power, if you like, is the gold standard of renewable. First of all, it has to be new renewable energy generation, not from hydros that were built 50, 60, 70 years ago. So it's new investment in renewable. So the whole purpose of Green Power is to get investment in new renewable, not old renewable. The old renewable's already been paid for and has been in the system for a long time. It's over and above the renewable energy target. So the government have legislated that retailers have got to buy a certain percentage of energy from a renewable source, from a new renewable source. Green Power is over and above that. So if anybody that buys Green Power is doing more than what legislation says they need to do. So if 20-30% of people in Australia bought their energy from a Green Power source, rather than 23% of energy coming from renewable energy as is legislated now, it could be 50 or 60%. It's over and above the target. And finally, it's not, when they look at it, they do probably one of the most contentious areas of renewable energy is the biomass is using native forest for burning to generate electricity. Under the renewable energy target, that's allowed. They can create renewable energy certificates for that. Under Green Power, they look at where the source of the supply comes from and they don't allow that sort of thing. So you've got to be an accredited generator to do it. So it's the gold standard. It's over and above, but it does cost a bit more.
Do you see an increase of the amount of solar installers?
Do I see an increase?
As in your business, will that contribute to the amount of demand of solar installers and that sector in job industry?
Growth in the You look, in our region, 20% of people already have solar. That will grow. We factored in, we say that probably over the next 5 years, it'll be another 10% people, potential, that we want to bring on. So we want to start to encourage people to put solar on. That's
And will you employ your own solar installers? Or?
Oh, sorry, how do we do it? We are a retail operation for solar. We will contract with solar installers, so we will buy the panels, we'll come out, we'll give you the advice, we'll sell you the panels, we will buy the panels and inverters from the manufacturers, and then we will hire accredited installers around the region to actually put them in. We won't be the installers ourselves. We don't want to put other installers out of business. We want to work with
you'll contract them to do the work for you.
Yeah. So we don't want to start to put others that are trying to do a good thing out of business. We want to work with them to help them. So we want to grow the pie so we can all get down.
So we look at like wind and like different technologies like wind energy and wave energy and all different and like concentrated solar thermals. Can you look at that, or is that too large?
Look, we're not big enough, nor do we have enough money to invest in new untried technologies. That's what the Clean Energy Finance Corporation or ARENA are really there for, is to give grants to companies that want to try a new form of generation before it becomes commercial, is to get those up and operating. I mean, if someone gets a grant and wants to put it in, we would certainly act as the retailer to buy the energy from it, but we're not likely to be the investor in that. We're not likely to be the investor in general generation. That's what we want the communities to raise the money for the generation, and we will buy the energy, we will underwrite it by buying the energy from those power stations that the community build and run themselves. So we're not builders and owners of generation as such. We might look further down the track, we might, but today we don't have the capital to be able to do it. I mean, once we've capitalised more, we can borrow money more than what we can today. They, those are the sort of things we might do in 5 or 6 years' time, not additional.
You mentioned energy efficiency as part of your offering. Was that something you're going to try and make it money out of, or is it just like a more community benefit that you're going to try and do that?
All we want to do is cover our costs, and we're not trying to make money out of that.
Yeah.
It's not a, we don't see that as a, that's our not-for-profit arm will do that.
Yeah.
So we're not trying to make money there. And, I mean, we have to employ people to go out and do it. We will probably seek grants to cover those costs of employment or material, whatever it might be, but certainly not to profit from it. That's not our intention.
How many people are involved in the company now, and you're kind of setting it up? And
we've got one full-time employee. Oh, sorry, we've got one part-time employee, and that's our marketing manager. The rest of us are all doing this out of our own pocket. We trip down today, my wife, the accommodation, the airfares, all I pay for just my money.
Do you have any businesses that are supporting it, or do you have any like qualified industries that are putting money into it?
We've had some early investors to help us get going with some of the costs, but we've taken on to get our retail license. There was nearly $60,000. We've taken that on ourselves. Legal costs, all of that, marketing costs, all out of our pocket. If we don't get up and operating, that's money we've done. If we do get up and operating, we will recover that money. But we're not, a lot like in a lot of startups, we're not, we don't have a an investment in the company other than the shares that we've personally bought. We're not going to become millionaires because this company gets up and operational. A lot of startups, the original founders get allocated half the shares or something like that. That's not the case in our company. I think the original founders, the four of us that founded, have got 5 or 10 shares each. I can't remember what was allocated. That's just to pay for the 12 months work that we've been doing for nothing.
So how long have you been started? How long have you been going for this? So when did you
we
first
got
start?
The grant. We received a grant from the Department of Environment and Heritage back in August, September. How it started, we'd all talked about, or a group of people talked about, lamenting the fact that there wasn't a friendly retailer to support what was going on, and someone said, look, why don't you do a feasibility study and see whether it's viable for a community to actually buy, to get a retail license and to run a retail business. They applied to the Department of Environment and Heritage for a grant, got a grant. We did the work, determined that it was quite economically viable to do it, and then moved into registering a company and starting to raise capital. So that's sort of the progress. So that was back in September last year. So we've been going, over 12 months now.
And sorry, I've come in late, but I'm just asking a question around your status. I think you originally had a goal of $3 million by the end of last month, and I think you extended for a month or so.
Yep.
How are you going now in terms of dollars?
We have, the last time I looked at the, we get a, we only see, when people invest in the company and put the shares in, it goes into a trust fund. In the registry office, we don't get the money. If we don't get up and operating, all the money goes back, 100% goes back to people that put in. We get a report once a week. The last, I think it was a week ago that I saw the report, it was 1.4 million actually in funds.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that from people that have applied for BPAY numbers, where we assume that they've applied that they're going to invest, we know what the average investment is, so we extrapolate that. And we also know that a third of people that have invested have actually done it not via BPAY, via sending in a cheque. So putting all of that together, we're closing in on that would give us about 1.8 today, and we think with the rest of the time we'll probably get to about $2 million through retail type investment. We need a couple of other large investors to get that extra million or so. We're talking to a couple of other large investors that might, what one has said that they'll put in enough money to get us over the line. I believe that when I see it. You know, lots of promises, but I believe that when I see it. If we don't, we're talking to a couple of organisations that have said that they'd be prepared to lend us the money to get us up and operational. Again, we've got to go through that process, and it does change the prospectus a little bit, because what we've said is we're going to issue 3,000 to 4,000 shares. If we only issue 2,000 shares then and get a loan for the balance, that changes the nature of the prospectus, so we'd have to go back and talk to people that have put the money in. So there's a bit of rigmarole to go through to that. But that's roughly where we are. I think we'll get there, but not raise as much through the community as what we, within the time frame, as what we would have hoped. Given a longer time, we could have probably.
Well, why did you go for 3 million? I think your feasibility said 2 million would get you where you wanted to be.
3 million. We need a minimum of 3 to get started.
3, yeah.
We'd like 4 to just give us a bit of buffer. 3 will get us through. 4, I can sleep with a night. yeah, look, the cash flow is a big issue with any startup, and particularly when you think about paying your electricity bill today. As a retailer, we send you a bill 3 months after you've used the energy, potentially, and then you might pay it within a month. So you've got credit for 4 months. We've already got the bill for the first week of energy you used. So we've already had to fork out to the network company, to the market regulator for the energy we bought, and other bits and pieces. We've had to pay salaries and so forth along the way. Before we've collected a cent, we're already 4 months. So cash flow is pretty important, and we need that money to give us that buffer for the cash flow, plus the other setup costs and day-to-day operational expenses. If we grow according to plan, we're fine. In fact, if we grow too quickly, it can be a problem. If we grow too slow, it can be a problem. So we've got a plan there that we need to grow at a steady rate to be. So just like we couldn't take on a very large company, for instance, the amount of energy a very large company would use, we couldn't afford the money to be able to take on a large company. So we tend to look at smaller, you know, mums and dads, you know, residential and small businesses is really our target market until we're stabilised and cash flow positive.
There's a company called Sungevity, and from what I understand, they are a finance company that will finance installations, yeah, and then meter. Are you going to do anything like that? Are you going to meter the energy that comes off your projects?
Yeah. And solar, there's probably 3 ways people can put in solar. One is, and Australia's are great at wanting to own things, not wanting to put things on hire purchase, with the exception of perhaps cars and a house. We tend to pay cash for those things. In the United States, it's quite a different culture. People are prepared to finance and take things on the never never for a whole range of things. Australians, our culture tends to be, when I've got the money to pay for it, I'll buy it then. So the people that have put solar on the roofs to date have pretty much been people that have got the cash to be able to do it and have installed it. What we're starting to see, though, is a new model coming into the market where you could either lease the panel so that you'll pay it off over time through the savings in the energy. So you'll save, by putting solar on, you might save $200 a year in your electricity bill. That $200 a year pays the leasing, or the interest costs, if you like, for the equipment and some of the capital. I think the model that we're going to see that's going to get more traction is we're going to bypass that model, where the model will be Enova will own the panels, that we'll put the panels on the roof and we will own them. And we will sell you the energy from those panels, but we'll sell it to you at a price much cheaper than what you would be able to buy energy from the grid for. So let's say your energy price from the grid is 30 cents a kilowatt hour, you can get a 10% discount, so 27. We would sell you the power, we would put the panels on your roof, and we will sell you that power for, say, 20 cents a kilowatt hour. That'll be enough to pay for our interest costs then, and start to pay off the capital. And at the end of 10 years, or whatever that period of time might be, we will then give you those panels. So we gift them back to the person, so they will own them eventually. So it's sort of a smarter leasing model. It's a bit more sophisticated. And that's what Sungevity and even Origin Energy have been given a grant by the Clean Energy Finance Corporation. They've been $100 million to try to introduce that sort of model into Australia. And others are looking at it. So I think that's more likely to be the model we're going to see in the future. I'm still not sure that people, you know, asking people to commit for 10 years is a long time. I mean, most people, 2 or 3 years maybe. So we'll see how that one plays out. But what we want to do, where we see the real benefit of that model, is actually for the rental market, for people that are renting properties. Why would a landlord want to put on solar panels on a rental? They don't get any benefit from it. Consumer that buys the electricity, the renter, the tenant gets the benefit from lower energy usage. But with that particular model, that might actually help the rental market, and that's where we see an opportunity there, dealing with landlords and saying, look, at the end of this time, we will actually improve the capital value of your property by giving you these solar panels, which will make your rental property easier to sell. So therefore, it's not going to cost you anything to begin with, and your tenants will get a benefit along the way. So that's the market that we want to. We want to develop that sort of model for that particular segment of the market. I'm not sure that for the owner-occupier that that'll be a massive attraction. Look, it might be, but time will tell on that one. But for the rental market, there is a great opportunity to do something like that. My voice is starting to run out, and people are starting to go to sleep, so I might call it quits there, unless there's another burning issue that someone wants to ask. No good. All I'd just like to say is thank you very much for coming along and listening today. I hope it's been of interest. And I hope it's inspired you to, if not buy shares in us, at least think about what the possibilities might be for your own community and what you could do in your own community. And I'd like to thank Cleaners again for hosting it today. And you want to do?
Yes. Well, I'm going to give a little bit of a brief introduction about Cleaners and what our current projects are on that. And then I'll go to sort of segue, but why we're interested in Enova. Okay, so CleanAs is basically, we're a not-for-profit association, and we're dedicated to driving through the uptake of clean energy in Newcastle and the surrounds through community-owned projects and activities. CleanAs is a goal of 100% renewable for Newcastle. So we basically do things by projects. We're a group. We've just gone live with a decent project at Hunter Wetlands, where we installed 48 solar panels on the roof of the coffee shop there, and we had the go live ceremony on Saturday. So and that's going to be, and we did that by fundraising, and we managed to fundraise it $20,000 in about 8 weeks. And the way we did it was we actually did it through getting people to sponsor a panel for a nominal $500. So either a person or an organisation or an office, and they went quick. And we basically raised all the money. So these panels are going to save the wetlands about $4,000 a year in electricity bills. And so that's now up and going and live. And because we've raised that money, we are now chasing match funding from New South Wales government for another $20,000, which hopefully we'll know in the next couple of weeks. And that will double the amount of panels we will put on. So we'll have 100 panels. We'll also do some judicious energy efficiency with some LED light placements and install an electric vehicle charging station at the centre. So that's just an example of the types of projects we do. We've also been involved in putting together a toolkit for community groups to be able to do their own renewable energy projects. And that's freely available from our website. You can download all the information for that. And we've currently got a project which is funded through Office of Environment Heritage, which is involved in developing a financial and business model to allow community groups to invest in community renewable energy. So, and this is a gap we've actually got currently in Australia as far as ability to do things. We've got donation models and they're quite successful. We've got limited investor models where we've got, where you can have 20 astute investors that can invest in a renewable energy installation. But for us, that doesn't necessarily mean community. It's not your mums and dad investors, it's business people that are investing in it, or people you personally know. So to be able to open that up, we're looking at a project to develop a new model for that. So I'll just move on to the segue into Enova. So community energy provides the opportunity for everyday members of the community to be involved in renewable energy in a tangible way. This can be through development, operating, investing, owning, and or benefiting from community-owned renewable energy installations. Now, today there's been a strong incentive to focus on behind-the-meter projects for community energy groups, like Cleaners and other groups around Australia, such as solar PV installations that are sized basically to the peak daytime usage of a host site. Now, this is somewhat of an inefficient use of resources, and it's in part due to the lack of adequate feed-in tariffs and local network charging structures within the electricity market. I was recently at a workshop run by C4CE. This is like an umbrella organisation of community renewable energy groups in Australia, and this was on increasing customer access to renewable energy technologies. There's good attendance from community groups and community energy groups, and also advocacy groups like rental advocacy groups, low-income housing people, different organisations. So accessibility, affordability and simplicity were the common themes on enabling access to renewable energy to renters and low-income housing. So that was the theme of what we were on about. From the workshop, we came up with three key areas of future focus. This was repayment mechanisms for home-based installations, such as, say, on-bill financing for rentals or bundled with community housing providers, development of greenfield sites, such as microgrids, in particular for Indigenous communities, and one that was very popular is to do with solar gardens. I don't know if people know much about solar gardens. These are very popular in the US at the moment, where you basically, individuals that don't have the ability to have solar on their own rooms, they may be renters, maybe in apartment complexes, they buy panels in a solar farm, and the energy produced from those panels is deducted off their electricity bill. So there's no tax involved in that investment. It's a deduction in your electricity bill. So there's quite a bit of interest in that area. So each of these areas, to some extent, requires an amenable energy retailer and underneath the actual network. So Enova, as an organisation, is interested in partnering with community groups to develop programs to assist vulnerable households, lower socioeconomic groups, and also to develop options to make solar take up attractive to landlords and renters. This is very pleasing to community energy groups like us. So CleanAs, as an organisation, is interested in a tangible way to show our support for Enova. So if you're interested in investing in Enova, invest in shares in Enova. But if you don't have $1,000 to invest, and you still like to support this venture, CleanAs is looking to find donations from members and supporters to acquire shares in Enova. So helping Enova get off the ground may provide a significant benefit for the future renewable energy generation projects. But at the same time, the shares might provide CleanAs with some much needed income in the form of future dividends. It might be small, but just every little bit counts. So judging from past donation efforts and donations, as we did when we raised money for the Hunter Wetlands, we should be able to raise at least $1,000. If we don't get there, which I doubt, I think we probably will, we've got a sister organisation called Pingala, who's recently been in the news for looking at putting solar panels on a brewery. So, of course, breweries seem to be more interesting than wetlands to Australians. So they're also raising donations to buy shares in Enova through crowdfunding. So if we can't raise enough, then Pingala's also doing a similar thing. So thanks for all for coming. And I'd like to invite you all for cake and refreshments and ask any tricky questions from the Enova folks here. So there is cake, there's tea and coffee in the next room, and it's an Irish whiskey cake, but I've got to admit, I ran out of Irish whiskey, so it's actually Scotch whiskey. Wow. The cake. So thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Come and have cake and have a chat.
Let it cool down.
Yeah.
That's probably a lot of money. Yeah. Thank you.